theorist. Among his notable works are the axiomatization of the concept of polarization, his work on malnutrition and unemployment, on the non-cooperative foundations of cooperative game theory, and the evolution of inequality, on which some of which he'll talk about today. It's always a pleasure to have you back here, Debraj, and particularly so today as a plenary speaker to talk to us about aspirations and inequality.
Thank you. Can you guys hear me? Thank you for that vociferous round of applause. To be back, I was telling Tom that if there's one thing I've accomplished more than him is that I've given more plenary talks here than he has. So I decided to put up a math problem which has nothing to do with my talk, okay? But in case you're bored, you can try solving it. And then in the question answer session, maybe you can tell me the solution. If somebody's in the other room, I don't know whether they can read the math problem, too bad. But that's what it is. Where? What?
They see this.
Oh, they see that? Oh, I see. Okay. Okay, good. Hi. Okay. Okay, so what I want to talk about today is a bit experimental. I don't know where it's exactly going to go, and I've been working on it for many years. But in part of it with my co-author, Gerhans Jenicott, who's at Georgetown. And here's another nice quotation from an article which I really like, by Maitrish Porikhit, my student who is not here, and Ashok Kotwal, about how during the UPA administration, economic growth was actually quite high, and it even accelerated over some periods. Poverty came down, infrastructure started getting built. But what they write is that growth can also unleash powerful aspirations, as well as frustrations, and political parties who can tap into these emotions reap the benefits. Here is somebody who is maybe liked by some of you and disliked by others, okay, but I still put him up. Very similar line, but this came out just after the elections, that those who have been made to wait very long for trickle-down, people with dramatically raised but mostly unfulfillable aspirations, have become vulnerable to demagogues promising national regeneration. It's this tiger of unfocused fury that Modi has sought to ride from Gujarat to New Delhi. Okay, it's a quotation, okay, so in case anybody's upset. Okay, but this is a quotation from me, okay? This is something that I wrote several years ago in the Journal of Economic Perspectives, that economists, mired as they generally are in a contextless description of human preferences, are nowhere close to a theory of socially defined aspirations, and for the double-edged way in which they might influence individual behavior, either constructively via a profitable chain of investment and reward, or destructively via frustration and violent conflict. And this is the topic that I'm interested in, okay? It's also implicit in the work of people like Albert Hirschman, so I'm not the first person to have thought about this. The particular model I want, so this is going to be just a modeling exercise for the period of this talk. I want to emphasize this two-way interaction between aspirations and social outcomes. The first is that I'm going to write down a model in which individuals have aspirations, goals, and this inspires them or it could frustrate them. Okay, I'll make this more concrete. And this gives rise, at least in the model, to a pattern of investment behavior, right? And this investment, of course, shapes, once you aggregate it up, it shapes overall growth and distribution in the society. The second part of the interaction is that the same overall growth and distribution in the society comes back and influences people's aspirations, right? And so aspirations are shaped not personally always, but by the lives of people around us. Okay, so it's this two-way interaction that I want to model here. So this paper will belong now to a growing literature on what one might call internal or psychological constraints on economic growth. Yeah? So one example of that is Hirschman's tunnel, which I've already talked about last year, so I won't repeat it. But essentially, it's a story in which a society will tolerate rising inequality for a while. There is a honeymoon period. But after that, they will get frustrated if that inequality keeps going for too long. It's also related to earlier work of mine. It's part of it is in my development textbook, in fact, in 98, but also the work of Arjuna Padurai on the capacity to aspire, this notion of failed aspirations. And then there is a bunch of papers now, I've just put up a couple of them, on how there can be psychological poverty traps. Okay, so it sort of paper belongs to this sort of literature, as opposed to an equally important, and perhaps more important literature. Okay, the only reason I'm emphasizing this is not to say that this is the predominant literature. Okay, but it's something that we should also take into account. So it's like redressing a balance issue. But the external constraints literature is something, of course, that we are all familiar with in this room, which is based on stuff like non-convexities or imperfect capital markets to generate poverty traps. Right. So those, you can think of those as external constraints on the individual, just as important, if not more important, than internal constraints on the individual. Okay. So let me go straight away into the model. I don't have a huge amount of, I think this is motivation enough that we're trying to build a model of socially determined aspirations, and let's see how that can work out in a simple setting. Okay. So the story I have is that this is a society with single parent, single child dynasties or strings, right, going all the way down. A parent starts off, each individual lives for a single period. So a parent starts off and has a lifetime wealth, which we'll call Y, okay, lifetime income or wealth, and divides that Y up between consumption and investment. Yeah? And then there's a standard production function, which gives you the wealth of the child. Let's call that Z, right? And then the process continues like this forever. So that's the model. Yeah, that's at least the production side of the model. Now, what's going to be new and completely different, okay, is the description of preferences. Of course, we know by now that you can put everything into the utility function, right? But I'm not going to put everything in the utility function in some completely random way. I want to do a very structured exercise, and then we can see whether the proof of the pudding is really in, you know, how it works, whether that's a tractable model, and so forth. So the idea that I have in mind is that a parent gets utility out of her own consumption, okay, and then gets utility out of her child's wealth, right, but gets it in a couple of different ways. Okay, so the first, which I'm calling W0 of Z, is just the standard intrinsic utility that one might receive, right? And then there are these additional utility kicks that the parent gets depending on where he manages to position his child in society. Okay, so there are these additional utility functions that are put down, and they depend on whether the child's income, if you go to the next line over there, whether the child's income, Z, goes above certain thresholds, which I'm going to call milestones or aspirations. Okay, so there may be several of them. I've just written down an n-dimensional threshold over here. So if the child goes beyond a particular, the first threshold A1, the parent gets an extra kick. Okay, maybe it's a status thing. The child now, you know, maybe has an education of some kind. I'm trying to capture this idea. And then there could be another kick, right? Let's call it A2. If the child gets, you know, finishes a master's degree, right? And a third kick, and so forth, right? So there could be a bunch of these things, and each one gives an additional jump in the utility function. Actually, it's not a jump, the whole thing is continuous, but you get these additional utilities coming in. Maybe the best thing to do is to draw a picture, but let me just say that I'm going to think of W0 as intrinsic utility. This is just names, just semantics, right? And WI, each of the WI you can think of as milestone utility, right? For crossing the ith milestone. And these are standard utility functions. They're the usual increasing concave utility functions. I've written down satisfying the inada condition at zero. Okay. So this is what the picture looks like. Okay. So the picture is that here's your W0. I haven't put the U in here. This is just for the child. Here's your W0. Then on top of that, if you manage to cross the threshold A1, then W1 starts up. Okay. And W1 sits on top of the W0. Right. And then if you manage to cross the threshold A2, then W2 starts up. Okay, and you get these extra utilities. Does everybody see that? Is that clear? By the way, you should ask me questions. Let's treat this as a standard seminar. This is not some plenary lecture type of thing. So And that way I can speak for, well, I won't use up the whole hour, but I'll. Is that accurate? When did we start? I've spoken for 10 minutes? Oh, you took, okay. I've spoken for 8 minutes? Okay.
You get a kick from income,
right?
And so it would give you the same kind of
except for what I'm going to put down in the next slide. Okay, you just hang on for a second. And here, okay. So just give me a minute, and if I haven't answered, you ask me again. Okay. So the first note I want you to understand that this map, this entire aspirations, the way I want you to think about it is that if a parent is really poor, okay, these A3, A4, A5, whatever these other A's. Kind of exist psychologically in her head, but they may be unattainable. They're just too far out, right? So the map is always present in everybody's head. That's a shorthand way of capturing the fact that richer people may have different aspirations from poorer people. And the way I put that in is to just have the entire map kind of psychologically there, but obviously, you know, A3 or A4 may not be reachable if you're starting with a very low income. Now, the other thing that I want you to note is that in this model, higher aspirations are always bad for happiness, even though I'm not going to do any welfare economics, okay? Aspirations are never a good thing. They just put pressure on you, yeah? They put pressure on you because they raise the A's, and therefore they make it further away for these other W's to start kicking in, yeah? But it can do sometimes good things because it can kick, you know, that's a level effect. But there can also be a slope effect, right, which might then give rise to more investment. Yeah? But in general, aspiration, just having aspirations is putting pressure on your kids, so putting pressure on yourself. Yeah?
So if the child doesn't reach that level, they are not allowed to parent is not allowed to revise.
Sorry?
If the child doesn't reach that threshold,
yeah,
parents don't revise their aspirations.
No, their aspirations are psychologically
fixed.
Given.
Okay.
Okay. But that doesn't mean that they're exogenous to the model.
Okay.
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 I'm going to come to that.
Yeah.
Okay. But they are fixed. They have their aspirations. Yeah. Okay. So now coming back to your question, right? What I want to do is I want to think of these thresholds as arising endogenously from the distribution of income in the society. Okay. So in an education setting, of course, that could also happen. It could be that the threshold that you need to cross depends on how many teachers you have to hire, and the wage rate of teachers might depend on the society. But then we are getting into a slightly different model from the standard models. Okay? So these aspirations are endogenous, and I want you to think of this map. So the A over there is a vector, right? The A1 to AN, and that's a function of the going distribution of lifetime income. So, Viji, coming back to your point, this is what gets implanted into parents. But it's not exogenous because the distribution of income in the society is endogenous. Okay? But they can't help it. That's what gets in. Okay, so I'm going to make some assumptions on this. I'm going to assume that this function psi is continuous. I'll come back to this. For those of you who are technical types of the room, this is an interesting issue. I'll come back to this later. Okay, that this is a continuous function, but what is it continuous on? On the space of distributions. So, in the usual weak topology on distributions, the next assumption I want to say is that the aspirations at any date for parents are never lower than the lowest income in the society, and they're not higher than the highest income in the society. Okay, they live somewhere. In the range of those incomes. The third assumption is that if incomes go up in the sense of first order stochastic dominance, then aspirations don't go down. Okay? And the fourth assumption is that if I take all the incomes in society and double them, then aspirations get doubled. Okay? So linear homogeneity of aspirations. Yeah? I don't think any of these assumptions are particularly obnoxious. Okay? Okay, now, the case when n is equal to 1, I want to think of it as a leading special case. I'll call that the case of single-step aspirations. Okay? So that's where everybody has a single reference point. For example, it could be some weighted average of the incomes in the society, right? And that gives you some very clean results. That's why I want to emphasize it. The other reason I want to emphasize it, that this single step point brings the model closer to models such as Kosygin and Rabin, who work in behavioral economics. There's a literature on reference points, except that those reference points in that literature are internally determined. Okay? And these are models where the reference points are externally determined by other people. And n greater than 1, as I was telling you, different milestones may become salient as the parents' wealth goes up. Yes?
So since you brought up Kosygin...
Yeah, but I don't want to bring him up too long. Okay, go on.
That's fine, then I can skip. So no, in principle, you could do that with your aspirations level with as the reference point, as long as you have rational expectations in terms of that exercise, because their internal equilibrium is essentially a rational expectation.
Exactly, but here it's not internal equilibrium.
Right, but you could have a rational...
In principle, of course you could. Yeah, we have rational expectations, but it's not internal to the individual, right? He's looking at society around them. Thank you, yeah. Okay, so what I want to do then is you have a question? Just one? Okay.
For every threshold, you have essentially considered only one dimension in which, say, consumption increases utility.
Right.
Now, does it at all matter in any meaningful sense if, say, at a threshold, I have a preference for consumption of my child, conspicuous consumption, as well as the investment in the child's education?
Right.
So there is
right.
a substitution possibility. Does it matter at all?
Well, I don't know whether it matters, but certainly one would want to do something like that in extensions of this exercise. I completely agree, but I'm not doing that here. It's just the simplest model that I could write down. But of course, you can think of a multidimensional aspirational setting, right? Okay, so here's the way in which I want you guys to think of the whole social equilibrium of this model. So we start with some wealth distribution at day t, right? Let's call that ft, right? And then that generates a vector of aspirations. And then with that vector of aspirations, a person with a particular income, okay, or a wealth, Y, then chooses investment, which I'm calling K, right, to maximize this utility function that I wrote down before. What's K of Z? K of Z is just the investment required, it's just the inverse function of the production function, just the investment required to catapult your child into having an income of Z. So that's what a parent does with income Y. Every parent does that, right? And then you aggregate up over all the parents, right? You get the distribution of investments in society. And you get FT plus 1, right? So starting from F0, this recursively generates a sequence, FT. And that's an equilibrium, right? That sequence is an equilibrium. The sequence might keep moving forever. It might stop in case you have a steady state, right? But the question of equilibrium existence here is trivial, right? You just start at F0, solve this problem, and keep solving it for the rest of time. And you just generate these distributions. Okay, so that's my notion of an equilibrium. Now, what I want to do is I want to ask some questions about how this model works, and to do that, and even for its own intrinsic sake, it might be useful to start by pretending, from the point of view of an individual, that aspirations are exogenous, and just try to figure out the effect of aspirations on investment. So I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to come back to the equilibrium question. Okay? So let's talk about how aspirations influence investment in this model. So we are doing one bit of that two-way interaction. Okay, so here's the, because we are dealing with models that are essentially non-convex, okay, here, so let me try to write down how I think is the easiest way to solve these problems, right? So I've written down a case with single step aspirations, so there's a W0 and then there's another step, right? And the other line, the convex line, you can think of as a cost function. What's a cost function? Well, it's just a utility loss in not consuming stuff today, right? So you could get U of Y, but you actually just consume U of Y minus, you consume just Y minus K of Z, right? You consume less, so that's a cost function. And because that utility function is concave, the cost function is convex, right? So now you can see how to solve this, right? There are at most two points where the first order condition holds, right? One to the left and one to the right, yeah? You just write down the two first order conditions and then pick out the one that gives you the higher utility, okay? So it's a non-convex problem, but it's not a nasty non-convex problem, right? It's a non-convex problem which involves just writing down a bunch of first order conditions and then just figuring out which one is best. That's all, yeah? So at most one local solution on either side, compare and pick the one with the highest payoff, right? And this idea is easily extended when you have n-step aspirations. There are at most n first order conditions that you need to write down, at most, because you may not be able to reach a whole bunch of them, right? So write them down, whatever they are, okay? Compare the payoffs and pick the one you like the best. That's the solution. So I wanted to write down a model which is like super simple to use in applications of different kinds. So that's why I've written it like this. So I'm going to say that an aspiration AI, a particular threshold, is satisfied if the optimum choice of the parent exceeds AI, okay? So he manages to put her child above AI. Then you say that AI is a satisfied aspiration. And we'd say it's frustrated if it doesn't exceed AI, okay? So the question is, when is a milestone satisfied? When is it frustrated? So this is the kind of partial equilibrium exercise where aspirations are exogenous that I want to try and conduct. So I just wrote down, in case you're interested in this exercise intrinsically, there could be many cases where aspirations are changing exogenously. For example, the rise of certain types of mass media, the internet, or maybe some exogenous change in the income distribution. I'm not pushing it, but you know, in case you're interested, it's there. Okay, so let me just tell you what the result is for the single step case, right? So under single step aspirations, okay, you fix the wealth of a parent and change her aspirations, okay? Then you can show, it's very easy, that there is a unique threshold value of the milestone below which aspirations are satisfied and above which they are frustrated, okay? And as long as aspirations are satisfied, you react by your wealth, your chosen wealth for your child, going up with aspirations, okay? You react positively to aspirations by investing more and more. So it's like a string which is getting tighter and tighter, and then it snaps, right? And when it snaps, then you drop your investment in your child. Then you say you're frustrated, right? And then your wealth becomes completely, your chosen wealth in your child becomes completely insensitive with respect to the aspirations. That's the bad part, right? So I wanted to capture this idea that for a while, aspirations can inspire you, but if they're too high, then you just give up, right? And then the whole thing snaps downwards, right? So the picture looks something like this, right? So the A's go like this, the wealth is fixed, Z is the chosen investment in the child, and for a while, aspirations pull up that Z, and then there has to be a discontinuous fall, right? And you go down below, and then you're just flat, you become insensitive. In a more complicated model where you didn't have these humps, but you have an S-shaped utility function, then the frustration zone, you could even react negatively to higher aspirations. But let's leave that extension out. Okay, and as you might imagine, the extension of this to multi-step aspirations is kind of trivial, right? What will happen is that, again, change. Now, what I'm doing is real abuse of notation on the x-axis, because that's a vector. Right? Okay, but that whole vector is going up. And as it goes up, then initially, let's say you're satisfying a high level of aspiration, right? The best of that vector, and you're doing really well, then boing, you get frustrated, you drop. But you may not get completely dropped out of the entire map of aspirations, but you drop somewhere into the middle, and then that inspires you for a while, okay? And then as that becomes too big, then boing, you drop down again. The vector of aspiration, that's why I said it's bad notation. It's a vector going up, okay? Just to give you a pictorial, I don't know how to draw four-dimensional diagrams. So that's the kind of story. Okay. So this frustration business is interesting, right? And that's the one that sort of Purikit and Ashok and Pankaj and all those guys, I mean, there is something to the idea that everybody can be growing in society, but some people can be getting frustrated at the same time, right? The idea being that if you have a promised 2% growth a year, would you take it? And the answer is possibly yes, but if half the people are growing at 10% a year, you may not like the 2%. Okay? There's nothing new about this. Everybody knows it. I'm just trying to write down a simple way to model it. Right? Which utility diagram? What's utility doing?
If you put it on the,
always, utility always falls with aspirations. Nobody likes getting pressured. The idea being that, so the welfare economics of this is problematic because what you have to do is think of another situation in which investment is suboptimal for some reason. And what the positive role of aspirations is that it can improve your child's utility. A higher aspiration for the parent is not great for the parent, but it's good for the child because the child starts with higher wealth. So utility moves in complex ways in this model. And why are you so interested in utilities anyway? Utilities, I mean, I just use the word frustration and satisfaction here for dropping short of aspirations.
Well, it's a bit misleading, right? Because it's just wealth. So that discontinuity is not something that people care about. That's not what they primarily care about, right?
No.
Isn't a discontinuity in what you primarily care about?
Right. Okay. So this is a good point to actually discuss this. Parents, by the maximum theorem, have their utility moving continuously in aspirations. Okay, that's what Som is saying. So the fact that their investment drops discontinuously doesn't mean that parents get discontinuously unhappy. They get continuously unhappy, right, from that point. However, the child's utility, the utility of the next generation, does drop discontinuously when this investment drops, okay? So there's a complex set of reactions that happens over here, okay? So I'm not trying to suggest that, I haven't written that there is a discontinuous drop in utility. There's just a discontinuous drop in investment, a discontinuous drop in child's utility, and then this stays flat. Investment in the child stays flat as aspirations become higher. Those are the only points I've made. So the only point I want to make here, in addition to the remarks I just made, is that, as I said, recall that aspirational growth always lowers direct utility, and if aspirations are frustrated, then there's no inspirational role either, right? So you lose out on both things. So there's this memorable quotation from Tocqueville, right, that the French found their position all the more intolerable as it became better, talking about the French Revolution. There's an interesting empirical literature. I know there are people in this room who have also been working on aspirations. There are interesting empirical literature on how if you lower the aspirations of low-income students, to keep it to reasonable levels, this actually might reduce school dropout. And there's evidence for that in the United States and for France. There's also another interesting story. There's an interesting study that I read which suggests that in a basketball match, teams that are slightly behind at halftime, okay, have a higher chance of winning the match than teams that are slightly ahead. If they're behind by quite a bit, then of course this is not true. But if they're slightly behind, so if you look on the left of the regression discontinuity, if you like, then they actually have a higher ultimate probability of winning. So it's a bit related to this sort of the inspirational aspect of aspirations. Okay, so that's the first piece that I'm going to put together in the in the later part of the talk. The second piece that we have to keep in mind to put together is what happens if I fix aspirations and I change individual wealth, okay? So you can think of there being a kind of two-dimensional comparative statics, right? One with respect to a person's aspirations and the other with respect to a person's wealth. But of course, these two things are moving usually at the same time, right? But I'm just doing it piece by piece. Okay, so let's do the second one. So now we fix the milestone. Let's call it A star, a particular milestone.